Hi, this is Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and on this edition of Classic Album Sundays Worldwide, we have something really special for you. As part of National Album Day weekend, we did a series of events at the John Peel Center with the John Peel Archive, and we celebrated the 30th anniversary of Sonic Youth's Daydream Nation with our special guest, Thurston Moore. 30 years ago this week, Sonic Youth released their classic album, Daydream Nation, which in my years was a harbinger of the mainstream explosion of alternative rock in the USA in the 1990s. Sonic Youth's uncompromising mentality helped kick down doors previously closed to the grittier side of music, helping to create a sense of faith in its commercial viability. Without the groundwork laid by the era-defining album, Daydream Nation, it's hard to imagine Nirvana, the Pixies, Mudhoney, Soundgarden, the Smashing Pumpkins enjoying the same level of critical and commercial attention. In fact, Nirvana's press officer confirmed, our idea of the top 10 was being as big as Sonic Youth, showing that Moore, Gordon, Ronaldo, and Shelley had become the contemporary barometers of rock and roll greatness. Sonic Youth's role as tastemakers would only increase throughout the 1990s. Although they were far from being the most commercially fortunate of all the bands, they remained a guiding light for many, the perennial cult figures of the avant underground, whose influence was felt beyond the aforementioned bands, to artists from other disciplines like Spike Jonze, Sofia Coppola, and Jason Lee, artists who would go on to define their own epic. John Peel supported Sonic Youth right from the start, from their 1983 debut, Confusion is Sex. And in that decade, he invited the band to do 3 Peel sessions. So it's fitting that we're celebrating the 30th anniversary of this iconic album with Thurston Moore at Classic Album Sundays at the John Peel Center. Thank you so much for coming. I know you've had a really whirlwind last few months, touring and everything.
Yeah, I came in from Latvia. I was in Latvia playing a duo with Mats Gustafsson, the saxophone player. And it was like a noise guitar and noise saxophone duo in Latvia.
How was it?
Oh, it was really fun. It was really cool.
I wanted to rewind to 1988. What albums were you listening to at that time?
Certainly, and I think we were talking about this earlier, it would have to be Public Enemies, It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back record, which was just completely... playing everywhere in the streets of New York City at that time. And that was such a radical, important record in New York because it really sort of galvanized all of the energy that was in punk rock and new wave and no wave and hip hop in sort of like a really sort of unified way, especially with sort of bands like the Beastie Boys becoming more political at that time. And it was just a really inspiring and intriguing record.
Any other albums that you were listening to around that time that you can remember?
Well, certainly my contemporaries of the band. I mean, Dinosaur Jr. were making like some of their most critical records at that time. But I think the Meat Puppets had made Up on the Sun maybe around that time. 88 is like such an incredible time. It's like when bands like My Bloody Valentine and Jesus and the Mary Chain are coming up and making these just completely significant records at the time that were just were really genuine in their creativity. They weren't really sort of playing off of anything other than their own sort of just like moment, and that was really exciting.
Those bands you mentioned before were bands that we played on college radio. I was on a college radio station, WNYU, at the time that Daydream Nation came out. And it was surprising that you went to the aforementioned Green Street Studios, because that's where Nick Sansano, who produced the album, he was recording the likes of Public Enemy, Rob Bass, Ice Cube. Why did you choose Green Street?
I think we kind of were sort of looking into what studios we could afford at the time, and we didn't really have any budget. There was no money around to play with, but with Daydream Nation, we had gotten involved with Paul Smith, who had a label in London called Blast First, which came out of Mute, Daniel Miller's record label. And Paul Smith started a label called Double Vision, where he worked with Cabaret Voltaire, and he wanted to sort of put other music out on Double Vision. And he, one of the records he did was a record with Lydia Lunch, and Lydia Lunch was a compatriot of ours. We had already recorded some music with her, and we were just, you know, we worked together. And she recommended Paul Smith to check us out, and he had a couple of people that he worked with, these two sisters, Liz and Pat Naylor, who were in New York City, and they went to see us, and they wrote back and said, well, they're kind of insane. They kind of come up on stage with drills and sticking drumsticks and guitars, and they kind of fall over a lot. And that was the only information he had, which was kind of like, parts of that are true, but we were actually really playing sort of songs as well. So he was intrigued by that, and he tried to get a hold of us. And at that time, we could only use the telephone. And I remember him calling Kim's mother's house in Los Angeles when we were staying there, and her mother would answer the phone, and she didn't believe that somebody from England was calling us. And so she would sort of hang up on him. And finally, we sort of realized what was going on, and I got a hold of Paul Smith, and he put out Bad Moon Rising, and we sort of and brought us over to England, and we kind of pretty much lived here for a few months, working in and around Rough Trade. And so Daydream Nation came out through Paul Smith coming to New York and setting up office there and wanting to do more work with bands from the USA. And he was putting out records by Big Stick and Steve Albini's groups, whatever he was doing.
The Big Black stuff and everything else he was doing.
And so between him and this other fellow at Mute who had a label called Kelvin K, and he put out Swans, and there was like this kind of like a lot of interest in putting out these bands that were sort of around our scene at that time. So to answer your question, Daydream Nation was pretty much sort of spearheaded by Paul Smith, this entrepreneur from London, or originally from Nottingham.
Now, it also is a much more advanced studio, because when you recorded Sister, it was on 16 tracks. I believe it was all kind of analog valve tube equipment, and now you have 24 tracks to play with. Was there a conscious decision to have like a bit of a bigger sound as well?
I think we always had this idea that, you know, bands like us in the 80s, making the kind of music we were making, which we thought was fairly radical, you know, in comparison to what was sort of being played on radio. And we always thought, like, what if a band like us made a record that sort of had the same production value as, say, somebody like Aerosmith? Like, what would that sound like? And eventually that came into play quite a bit, and all of a sudden it was like, it was no big deal. It's like, it just sounds like what it sounds like. I mean, to me, like, the best sounding records are records that are just made by groups that are just completely inspired, regardless of what the technology is. But working in a 24-track studio was a little unwieldy, because there was just more to contend with, and I don't ever think we really accomplished that sound idea of like sounding like an Aerosmith record or something that produced. You know, I never really felt like, oh, we actually did that. It just sounded like it was just kind of more to work with. The idea was to actually make a more expansive record, though. I remember that was a very conscious decision, to actually do a double album.
I was going to ask you that. Yeah. So why was there? I mean, I know that Lee Ronaldo's obviously famously a Deadhead, and you might have the Live Dead as a double album, but there weren't a lot of double albums in this kind of sphere of music that you were involved with, except for Zen Arcade, I think, was double.
Yeah, I think that Grateful Dead, that was like a triple album.
It was a triple album. Well,
yeah, that was just too expansive. That was like, that was jamming. We weren't into jamming. We were like into improvisation. No, I mean, yeah, it was more defined by what had been going on just with bands like the Minutemen and Husker Du. The Minutemen did Double Nickels on the Dime, which was kind of a response to Husker Du's Zen Arcade. The idea of making a double album at that time was a conscious thing, because it was, nobody was really doing that. There was very few examples of it. And we thought both Husker Du and the Minutemen records were so cool. I mean, I would have liked to have done like a triple or a quadruple album, which, you know, would have been kind of ridiculous. But making a double album was really sort of part of the plan. I mean, we weren't trying to do anything except for get a record out and then go on tour and try to break even. I mean, we all had day jobs and nobody, you know, we weren't like, the Sonic Youth wasn't supporting our lifestyles. We all had, you know, we had to pay rent and, you know, be able to buy peanut butter.
Talking about doing a double album, you would have had to spend a lot more time writing, I would assume. And was there a different approach to writing? I was watching some old interviews with you, circa 1988, and you said the writing style was anarchistic.
Anarchistic? I remember, you know, we would write songs in these kind of rehearsal studio situations in downtown New York, and those cost money as well. And the fact that we didn't really have any money, it would really sort of prohibit too much of a sophisticated space. And so they would generally be basements that were about this, maybe half the size of this stage, and then we would just be kind of really close to each other. So we couldn't really blast or anything like that. So it was, interestingly, we would write songs at a fairly sort of low volume, you know, together. And it was, and so in a way, the quote unquote experimental aspect of our music, I always thought was more to do with structure, with song structure. That's where we were really experimenting. It's like, what can be validated as a song, you know, and working with structure, and like, you know, where verses can be or where choruses can be, if they're going to be at all, you know, and like where they're placed and how things can move and like what that flow is. And that was, I think, where we really sort of became experimental. The other aspects of, you know, how we tuned the guitars, how we strung the guitars, how we would sort of modify the guitars with different implements, that was really easy. I mean, anybody could do that, and other people were doing that, and we would employ that, but I never really thought of that as so much experimental as just sort of just expanding like the aspects of the instrument. And that was just like, you know, anybody can do this. I mean, it's just like, this is super fun to do that. But the true experimentation was in the actual writing. And I thought that's what was happening when we were playing together, and that kind of nonverbal discussion of like how a song was happening. And that was really always the most enlightening thing for me, and of being in a democracy like that. I remember one thing that I kept bringing more sort of ideas that I thought were kind of sort of conservative in a way, as far as like sort of song structure, because I thought in a way for us to do anything in a conservative way was radical, because the fact that we were using sort of alternate tuned instruments and stuff, and so to bring in these other sort of kind of more basic ideas of songwriting into using these instruments, I thought that was just kind of this interesting kind of dialogue between the radical and sort of like the more traditional. But I always I remember doing that. I remember actually one afternoon while we were writing, where I could see maybe Lee kind of wanting to sort of just like tear that away, and just like sticking things in his guitar and like turning on these different pedals, and like, no, let's just destroy, let's create some destruction and build from that. I remember thinking like, oh, that's really cool that he's like, he just like we need that in the band or something, and that really connected. But as far as like the songs on this record, Daydream Nation, they came together very quickly. We were really fast songwriters, you know, and I don't think we really belabored too much over composition. And I think we did later, after that record, we would get a little more heady into it, where you would spend like weeks trying to sort of figure out how to make certain material work. But for that record, things really happened fairly quickly. There's one song on the record where I remember writing the lyrics on the way to the studio, and the lyrics were written about walking to the studio.
So it's written really quickly.
Yeah, I think it's a song that's in the it's one of the last songs. There's like this trilogy at the song at the end. There's a song called The Wonder, and there's Exterminator. There's a song in the middle of it called Hyperstation. I think Hyperstation is that song that I'm talking about. And it was just like, the lyrics were sort of written. There was other information in there as well, but that was written about actually like walking. And so I sort of name checked some of the streets from our apartment on the Lower East Side to Green Street Studio.
Amount of not necessarily always name checking, but certainly pop cultural references within this album, and also in the video for Teenage Riot. And it seems that as a band, you were you didn't really mind wearing your influences on your sleeves so much. Could you kind of talk about some of these different references throughout Daydream Nation?
Yeah, I mean, I think we always felt like we really, especially at the time of recording that record, we felt like we were officially in sort of this lineage of sort of downtown New York progressive art and music. And so we had all sort of gravitated to New York City. And New York City is interesting because there's very few people that I knew that actually were native to the city. Most of the music that was really indigenous to New York City was primarily hip hop coming out of the outer boroughs of Brooklyn and the South Bronx and Upper Manhattan. And I thought, also a lot of Latino music was very indigenous to New York. But as far as sort of music that was post no wave rock music, it was mostly made by people coming from outside of Manhattan to come into the city to be where the models for what they were interested in were already there. I mean, be it like Andy Warhol's Factory or the Velvet Underground or the early Maxis scene around television and Patti Smith and all this, and people coming to be part of that. And even a lot of those people, like Andy Warhol was from Pennsylvania. I mean, it was just like, so that whole kind of scene was always sort of people coming out of university or other parts of the world coming into New York to do their thing in a way that defined a lot of that activity in Manhattan. And I felt that's kind of, we were sort of the same kind of thing as that. And so we were just kind of ravenous about our influences, you know, be it music, art, literature. And we were really into sort of having that influence be really kind of celebrated. I mean, we really wanted to celebrate it. We never felt like we were covering it or copying it. We really liked the communitarian aspect of it. We liked that idea of this kind of collective of sort of challenging any kind of standard expectation of, you know, who you are as an artist. So certainly people like Allen Ginsberg and Ann Waldman, Diane DePrima, or Amiri Baraka, these kind of writers, and then, you know, certainly musicians like Lou Reed and Philip Glass and John Cage and Patti Smith and Debbie Harry, you know, these were all really important people to us. And so when we made the video for Teenage Riot, it was basically taking a lot of the documentation that we had of it at that time, which existed only on these kind of VHS tapes, these videotapes, which at that time was kind of a new thing. The idea of actually having some of this history, moving image history on a videotape, was really exciting because, you know, in the 70s, you didn't really have that. I mean, you would have these memories of seeing things on the television and you could talk about it. And then all of a sudden you had these VHS tapes, and then things started appearing on them, and then people started trading them and collecting them and saying, and so we were doing that. And so between all of us, we had all these clunky VHS tapes that had all these like really grainy, old, kind of warped images of video images of like Sun Ra or Patti Smith, like, you know, like some kind of weird concert in Central Park. And we just took parts of all these different videos and we overlaid them. We had a video of us playing that Richard Kern, the filmmaker, had made in his apartment
Richard
building.
Kern films at the gas station.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so we just peppered that video with all these images, and it's just like really, you know, to fit in the time of that one song. And we just did it for fun. We just went to a little video editing place that was near the Strand bookstore. At the time, Lee and I did that, and we went up there and we did it, and then we showed it to everybody, and everybody liked it. We weren't really thinking of, like, I mean, MTV was happening at that time, but we weren't really thinking of anything except for just making like some some kind of movie. But yeah, I really love that video. I think that was kind of that kind of really captured the aesthetic of the band more than anything at the time.
Yes.
I wanted to ask you, and I'm going to just hand you a copy, my copy of the record. I think it has a track listing in there. In any case, what's one of your some of your favorite songs on the album?
I mean, Teenage Riot is like, you know, to me, that song was like really, you know, that song was inspired by when we first started becoming aware of Dinosaur Jr., who were just called Dinosaur before the Jr. And Jay Maskus was really a curious musician to us because he was such a remarkable guitar player and songwriter and singer. And so we befriended him pretty early on, and we would take his band out on tour with us. And I remember visiting his family's house in Amherst, Massachusetts, and going into his bedroom. But you couldn't really go into his bedroom because it was completely and utterly like destroyed. And it was like records and books and magazines and like leftover pizza boxes everywhere, strewn everywhere. The, you know, and the bed was upside down. I mean, it was just completely like, it's just wonderful. And I just thought of it as like, it was like a teenage riot. Like there was like this riot. And he was the most calm kind of centered person in his own way. It was like the beauty that he was evoking was like, was really political in a way, because he was like, there was no articulation besides that. And that was like this true art. And I thought that was like really sort of like the new youth sound, the new sound of the youth that I thought was really important, like making this kind of intelligent music, you know? And it had this kind of really genuine intellect to it. And that's sort of where Teenage Riot comes from. And the way that song starts with that really sort of minor guitar thing, I always remember sort of just kind of fooling around with that and Lee pointing at it and going like, what's that? And so kind of sticking that on at the beginning of that song, and then Kim does that recitation on top of that song that she wrote. And then, you know, and I always, and then the lyrics that I wrote for that song, I always remember kind of really working on them, being inspired by that time and that moment, and then playing that song for the first time at a place called Maxwell's, which was a club in Hoboken, yeah. New Jersey. And having the lyrics written down in a notebook, and sitting there with the group, the four of us, having some food, and just Steve's going like, can I see the lyrics that you just wrote for the song? And it was called Teenage Riot. And then everybody sort of being excited that we were doing this new thing, and feeling that there was something happening. Because it was just then that people started actually taking us seriously a little bit. Because I think, you know, bands just don't last very long. And so I thought there was this idea that maybe we were going to go the way of most bands, which is like, just, it's over. But at this point, we were kind of, we knew that things were becoming a little more sort of pronounced. And I could feel it with the people coming to see us. Like, you know, you're taking us with a little more credibility, maybe.
Teenage riot in a public station, gonna fight and tear it up.
Within the album's grooves, of course, is references to William Gibson, but also people like Joni Mitchell, Eliminator Jr., ZZ Top, Dinosaur Jr., I think. So these kind of pop cultural references. And it seemed to me in a way also, especially with Teenage Riot, that maybe you were also maybe making a statement possibly about the state of rock and roll music at that time. I'm thinking of songs like Ode to Bob Dylan by David Bowie, or what Patti Smith did on Horses, where they kind of felt that, you know, where did Bob Dylan go? Where's rock and roll? Or Patti Smith kind of singing about the Doors and trying to bring back this spirit of rock and roll. How did you feel about the state of rock and roll at the end of the 80s?
I thought the state of rock and roll was just like wide open. I mean, to me, it was so exciting at the time. You know, I remember doing an interview right around that time, right when we were getting into the 90s. With an interviewer who was just sort of disparaging the 80s as this kind of lost era, and I was like, au contraire, I think there was 10,000 incredible records that came out in the 1980s. The rock writer Byron Coley and I were trying to compile a list of that. We were going to do a book of like the 10,000 greatest records of the 1980s, which we're still working on, actually. Yeah, so I thought there was so much good music happening. I thought like, what was happening in hip-hop was like becoming really, really exciting at that time. So I felt like getting into the 90s, like things were just like super interesting and exciting. And seeing young people who were starting bands that I had seen in our audiences at the time in the 80s, like starting bands. So like the advent of bands like Nirvana or Pavement or, you know, was fascinating because they were referencing music that predated punk rock in a way that, you know, was something that for our age, as a band starting in 79, 80, I mean, I was in a band in 77 in New York, and then Sonic Youth starts around 1980. But it all sort of morphs from these different groups of people that we were all playing with, all like in the late 70s. And so the fact that we sort of come together as the three of us primarily in 1980 is, it doesn't come out of a void. We had already been doing work with different music in the 70s in New York City. But at that time, there was a real line in the sand about any music that predated 1976. You kind of like got rid of all those recordings, and it was a real standoff of creating like a completely new identity defined by that moment in 1976 of just like punk rock and like moving forward. And realizing that punk rock was like this really sort of liberating new force of just being completely experimental in like what you were gonna do. Even though there was like this really sort of purist traditional aspect of punk rock, there was also this obviously this world of just like being able to do whatever you want and like punk rock being whatever you wanted it to be. And so music predating 1976 was off limits for a long time. You know, and it wasn't until like the 80s when certain bands started referencing that and became really, again, exciting to sort of reinvestigate it. When a band like Black Flag started growing its hair longer, you know, that was just a really radical move. Nobody in their right minds were going on stage with short hair, but they did. Short hair and straight leg pants and like, you know, button down shirts.
1950s style.
Yeah. It was like this kind of nouvelle vogue thing, you know. That was such a radical visual at that time, because, you know, if you're going to be in a rock band, you had long hair and flares and all this kind of stuff. So anyway, I mean, in the 80s, when underground bands started referencing music predating 1976, it was kind of daring, you know.
I remember watching another video of yourself around circa 1988, and you had all these files on different musicians. You said, here's my file on Patti Smith. This is pre-internet. So you had to have physical, you know, you couldn't just like look something up. You had to have VHS cassettes or newspaper clippings. Do you consider yourself a music fan first or a musician first?
That's a good question. I mean, I think I'm a complete sort of fetishist I don't know what I am. I come from a family where there was always music activity. My father was a musician, and so I was always playing music, you know. But I never really sort of. My ambition was to be a writer, musician, or whatever. Just do it. I mean, so. But I was always sort of completely and utterly a fanboy. Yeah, for sure. I mean, I wasn't like a fan where I was like, you know, waiting for autographs or this kind of thing. I didn't really care about that kind of connection so much. I was more interested in the work as opposed to the personality so much. I didn't really want to sort of like, you know,
the cult of personality and all the kind
of... Yeah, possibly. I was really interested in sort of like the sort of the documentation. I was really into the sort of the vibrational kind of tactile world of it, you know,
the archival world.
Yeah. I mean, there was this great interview I saw with the jazz composer Sun Ra, where he was to tour Egypt, and he told the Egyptian promoter to send some fabric from Egypt to him so he could touch it, so he would be acquainted with like the world he was going to enter into. And I was like, that was really interesting in this kind of physio-spiritual way. And I really always liked sort of the idea of the documents, because I think they have a real sort of spirit alive to them. Silver Rocket to me is probably my favorite song on the record.
Why is that?
Because it kind of really sort of exemplified what I really wanted to do in a band, which is just create like this kind of really hyper sonic guitar music, you know, that was sort of informed by the name Sonic Youth, which is, I came up with that name just because I wanted it to be this music that referenced kind of high energy, kind of working class rock and roll, like MC5, like the Motor City 5, MC5, the Stooges. And the youth name came more from reggae music. It came from like Big Youth and the idea that reggae music always talked about like having to protect and honor youth culture and educate it in the right way. And that was a very sort of, the music was so spirit-minded. It was such a spiritual music, reggae music and dub reggae. And so Youth was all about that, because it was before hardcore, like, you know, punk rock hardcore. It was all these bands like Reggae Youth and Youth. It was mostly, it was about reggae. It was about like the youth. And so Sonic Youth was those two things together. It was like this. And so Silver Rocket to me was kind of really this song that I think we would kind of replicate over and over again, where it had this kind of first chorus and then like noise breakdown and then verse chorus and then we're out of there. And so we created a bit, that's sort of like that was sort of the beginning of that template was right there.
Thank you.
The Sprawl, which was like a really sprawling song, I remember writing that in a trailer in Northern California, in a fishing village that that Kim's family used to sort of spend the summers in, and staying in this trailer, and I had the guitar with me and just writing that music, just the music of it. But all these songs, the song Cross the Breeze is such an intense song that I was really knocked out that only a few years ago, maybe about 6 or 7 years ago, I got a letter from some guy who was like in a really super underground black metal group, and he was telling me that you do realize that Cross the Breeze is like the song that a lot of black metal bands sort of reference as like one of the few non-black metal bands' music that is pertinent to the sound of black metal. And I couldn't tell if he was pulling my leg or not, but I realized that it made a lot of sense. Knowing that song. But no, I don't have a, I mean, favorite song, I would say maybe Silver Rocket. I would say that whole first side of that record is up until Cross the Breeze. And then, I don't know. What's your favorite song?
Might be a bit uncomfortable to answer this, but I'm going to ask it anyways. And the sense is 30 years later, and you look back, and sometimes you can almost gain a better understanding of where your album sits in the cultural sphere. Do you feel that in some ways Daydream Nation was kind of the breakthrough album that kind of gave an outsider's perspective to a wider group of people, and it was just about to break into mainstream America?
Possibly just because the fact that Paul Smith with Blast First and really sort of promoting this record through Mute, bringing it to a company in the USA that sort of kind of had wider distribution than, say, SST was sort of stuck in at that time. He was very instrumental in this record, being promoted further than any of our records were promoted. I think it was also at a time where people were really, anybody who sort of had any kind of marginal or sort of peripheral curiosity about our band came to this record. And critically, it was in New York City, which was our hometown, there was the newspaper, The Village Voice, which was fairly internationally known as a cultural hip newspaper. They had this annual Pazin Jop poll, they called it, which is a play on the word jazz and pop. And that was spearheaded by the rock writer Robert Christgau, and it was a voting by all these rock critics from all over with their favorite records of the year. And so I don't think we ever really figured in the Pazin Jop poll previously. I mean, possibly very low on the poll, but this year the number one record was It Takes a Nation of Millions by Public Enemy, and the number two record was Daydream Nation, and that was really big for us. I mean, and I didn't really expect that, and I remember seeing that and thinking like, oh, this is the ultimate. And so it was like one of these things of like, you know, what can be the ultimate? You know, the ultimate would be like, you know, having Iggy Pop come out and sing I Want to Be Your Dog with you, which happened. So, you know, I lost sleep for a year after that. And then sort of like being in the top of this poll, which was really important to me, like because it was very hometown and it did speak to the rest of the world in a really big way. Certainly being played on John Peel's radio station is huge. I mean, you know, that was like so cool, you know. These things are really, you know. It was a really sort of critical marking point for us. And it was shortly thereafter that we started talking to like corporate labels interested in putting our records out, which kind of had its pros and cons, you know. It allowed us to stop working day jobs. You know, we were able to get health insurance, which as Americans was something that you could only get through working at companies, you know. So at that time, to be able to attain such a thing was, we were getting a little older too. And so it's like the idea of like not having a day job and maybe being able to sort of focus all of your attention on what you really want to do and be devotional to, which is being an artist and playing music, and maybe someday having children and having families or being, you know, having a more serious domesticated situation. This is the beginning of it, for sure.
There you have it, Thurston Moore on the 30th anniversary of Daydream Nation by Sonic Youth, at a time when there was really a feeling of convergence surrounding the band and the American underground rock scene, and that multiple strands were forming into something solid and impactful. And Daydream Nation was the bold breakthrough album that really brought an outsider perspective to a wider American audience. Thanks so much to Thurston Moore for joining us. Thanks to the John Peel Center for having us. Thanks to the John Peel Archive for lending us John Peel's personal copy of the album. And thanks to all of you for listening. And I'll be back next month with a very, very different album for our Album of the Month on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide, Sade's Stronger Than Pride. Thanks for listening.